Hyperventilation. If there is one thing that we are taught in freediving courses, it is to never hyperventilate. So how come for static apnea, more and more we are hearing that advanced freedivers, competitive freedivers are doing some kind of breed up that is hyperventilation? Let's talk about this. So first of all, what is hyperventilation? Hyperventilation is breathing more than you need to. It is overbreathing. So there is hyperventilation, which means more, and there is hypoventilation, which means under. The baseline is called tidal breathing. When we breathe in a normal way, when we're not even conscious about breathing, just normal, relaxed breathing, that is called tidal breathing. And the volume of exchanged gas in tidal breathing is about half a liter. So with every normal inhalation, and it is through the nose, of course, because in normal daily life, we're supposed to breathe through the nose. The volume of the inhalation is half a liter. Volume of exhalation is half a liter, of course. So the volume of exchanged gas is half a liter. If we would breathe more than that, more than half a liter, more or less, that would be called hyperventilation. So the technical aspect of that is when you breathe deep and rapid. Not just deep, because if you would be breathing slow and deep, then the volume of exchange gas over a minute's time, over a time period of a minute, could be the same as tidal breathing. Let's say I do one big breath, but very slow, something like, and I keep on going 30 seconds, and then I exhale for another 30 seconds. That would mean we have one respiration, one ventilation per minute. And it could be that the volume of exchange gas is actually the same as when you would be breathing several times on tidal breathing, but only exchanging half a liter. So hyperventilation is deep breathing and rapid breathing. And it looks something like this. Well, we're going to do hyperventilation through the mouth, because if you do it through the nose, it will be quite impossible, because you cannot get that much volume through the nose. So that's why nose breathing is beneficial, because you breathe less. But when people start hyperventilating, it's usually through the mouth, and it looks like this. So if you keep on doing this for a minute or 2 minutes or several minutes, then definitely this is hyperventilation. Now, in freediving courses, we learn to never hyperventilate. Never hyperventilate when you are diving vertically or when you are diving horizontally. Just in freediving, don't hyperventilate. And why is that? Well, first of all, I need to explain you what is the BOHR effect. The BOHR effect is an effect that describes the way that oxygen in our system is released to our tissues, to the extremities of our body, our fingers, toes, to the vital organs, to the brain, which is the most important organ. So how does this work? When you have healthy levels of carbon dioxide, CO2, and healthy levels would mean not too low. So healthy levels of carbon dioxide would mean a little elevated levels. Then the oxygen that is tied to your red blood cells, and it's actually tied to the hemoglobin, which is a red protein inside of the red blood cells, then this hemoglobin will release the oxygen better if there is a bit of acidity in the blood. And acidity means that you have healthy or higher levels of CO2. The opposite, when you have lower levels of CO2, that would be when you have been hyperventilating. So when you hyperventilate, you are basically exhaling that CO2 and your body becomes more alkaline and less acidic. So when your CO2 is low due to hyperventilation, then the red blood cells, which have the hemoglobin, will hold on to the oxygen, and the oxygen will be distributed in a less efficient way to your vital organs. So the BOHR effect is an effect that says that the best way to distribute oxygen within your system is when you have healthy or slightly elevated levels of CO2, which is the opposite of low CO2, and low CO2 you get when you hyperventilate. So the message here is, do not hyperventilate, because when you hyperventilate, your oxygen will be distributed in a less efficient way to your vital organs. So that's why in freediving, we teach tidal breathing. Whatever it is you do, whatever kind of discipline it is, also static apnea, whatever you do in a scope of freediving, you're doing tidal breathing. So whatever kind of breath hold you're doing, whether that is diving or swimming in the pool or even apnea walking or just holding your breath, always do tidal breathing, which is just relaxed, small breathing. Now, what is the big exclamation mark here? You've seen more and more that advanced freedivers are using some kind of hyperventilation in static apnea, only in static apnea. So you might have asked yourself, like, what's the deal with this? I mean, in freediving courses, we always learn to never hyperventilate. And then on social media posts, when we follow certain influencers, we can see that they are actually hyperventilating for static apnea. Not all of them, but some of them. And they are getting pretty damn good results with this. So what's the deal with this? So, before I go into that, let's explain first, what is this hyperventilation breathe up? It is called a 5-5 breathe up. So you're going to inhale during 5 seconds and exhale during 5 seconds. And this will be done through the mouth to control the flux of air going better in and out. So in your head, you're counting more or less 5 seconds for the in and exhalation. It looks like this. And you keep on doing that for several minutes. No pause in between. Just always in, out, 5 seconds. That is considered a mild hyperventilation breathe up. Heavy hyperventilation would be like, we don't do that. So what is thought these days in courses for static apnea, well, not freediving courses, but some advanced freedivers use this breathing method, is called mild hyperventilation, 5 seconds in, 5 seconds out. So why are we doing this? Well, obviously, because hyperventilation delays your contractions. And when you delay the contractions, it's just easier to hold your breath longer because the relaxation phase will be extended big time when you can delay your contractions. So yeah, you can ask yourself, but Gert, why aren't we hyperventilating on everything then? Well, specifically because of this BOHR effect. So the question is then, why are we using it anyway in static apnea? And the answer to that question is, I cannot give you an answer that is that has a scientific background. We don't know. So we can only assume, of course, that it is because of, in static apnea, you are not moving. You're just totally still. So when you are not moving, you are using the least amount of energy, the least amount of oxygen possible, just to keep your vital organs and functioning and your blood flowing. But you're not consuming any kind of oxygen or energy to move around because you're static. And probably or more from an experience standpoint, from the standpoint of just trying out stuff, this seems to work. So there are breath holders who hold their breath over 8, 9, even 10 minutes who are using these kinds of mild hyperventilation breathe up. So besides delaying of contractions, once these contractions come, they also come faster. So this is something that you have to know about contractions. Yes, you can delay them by doing hyperventilation only for static apnea, but once they come, they will come faster. Now, because static apnea is such a psychological, such a mental discipline, and it's very hard to just be in the zone, stay in the zone, this might actually be beneficial for this discipline to delay the contractions as much as possible. And that's why apparently this mild hyperventilation breathe up is beneficial. So what is the conclusion? The conclusion is basically, it's up to you to try this out. So what is the best breathing method, the best breathe up method for static apnea? There is no best breathing method. So freediving is not a sport in which we search for the best this or the best that. Freediving is a discovery. It's a tool to get to know yourself. There are pretty badass breath holders who do not use this hyperventilation method. They just do tidal breathing. Well, they hold their breath for 7 minutes or maybe more. But if you are honest, the top breath holders at this time for the official discipline, static apnea, they are using mild hyperventilation. So it is up to you to try this, experiment with both, but know that in any kind of discipline in freediving, besides static apnea, we always use tidal breathing. And the hyperventilation method is only suitable for static apnea. So will you train your CO2 tolerance better with hyperventilation? Probably not. So if you want to use breath holding as a tool to make you a better deep diver, then I would advise you to use tidal breathing, because tidal breathing is anyway what you're going to use for diving. But if you are solely only concentrating, focusing on training for static apnea, just with the sole goal of holding your breath longer, then you might want to try this mild hyperventilation methods. If you're static, what would your amount of PECs be prior to static? This is something that you just have to figure out yourself. I do not train for static specifically. I use breath holding as a tool to become a better freediver. So of course I will mimic the circumstances of a deep dive. So on deep diving, I do not pack. So I don't pack on static either. That's as simple as it is. So if you're solely going for static with the sole goal of wanting to hold your breath longer, well, then you might want to pack, but you can only pack as much as your elasticity or flexibility allows you to. So I cannot answer that question. You have to answer it. You have to stretch and become more flexible. And the more flexible you become, the more you can pack. So you start with a couple of packs, with 3, 4, 5 packs, and you see how it feels. If it's too stressful, then it's probably too much. If it feels good, well, next time you might want to pack 3, 4, 5 times more. If it's too stressful, then it's too much. And that's how you increase your number of packs. So all questions in freediving basically come down to try it out yourself and learn to assess the situation, learn to feel, learn to be honest with yourself, and don't try to find answers that other people give you, like this is how it should be. And this, everything is very personal. So it depends on your flexibility and how you feel. If you can pack 15 times, but it feels awful and you can't relax in your breath hold, well, then you pack too much, yeah, right? So this is something that you have to decide, and peace in every breath.